what a lovely weather you've come in. We Indians love this weather. I know you don't, some of you don't. Because I know when I was posted in New York, and I used to say, what a lovely weather. They used to say, what a grey weather. So what was grey for them was beautiful for me. Anyway, where are you all from?
Different countries.
Different countries.
Mexico.
Oh, wow, Mexico all the way.
Belgium.
Scotland. Wow.
India.
Lovely. That's closest home.
They've all come on the Deccan Queen.
Oh, the Deccan Queen. And you traveled in India, did you? By now?
Yes.
All the way from Mumbai by train.
Oh, by train. To
the tip of India.
Oh, yes.
Kenya.
You're amazing how you come visiting my country. Despite all the challenges we have here, you seem to be wanting to be looking at our challenging chaos. We got huge challenges of 1.3 billion. 1.3 billion is whole of Europe, whole of America, and all of many Latin American countries. It's no ordinary situation where the population outdid infrastructure. And with income-generating population not so income tax paying generation, probably just 4%. While you have a GST, a general tax on every product you buy. But when you come to income tax, there's not many, there's a very small percentage which pays. But rest of it is more on welfare. But it's moving towards greater and greater. But the key is that now you buy, whatever product you buy, but still many projects are exempted from even the normal taxation. So when you create those projects, you are employing people. It gives you employment generation, which moves people up because then they're earning. So India is that's why it is the largest democracy in the world. 1.3 billion. Whereas many, many countries with few million. And see how, and with so much of idling natural resources. India is not so well natural resources, just has no oil, literally no oil, very little. But there's plenty of coal. And with the coal throwing up its own challenges of pollution. So plenty of challenges. Anyway, welcome to the largest democracy in the world.
Thank you.
Of which I'm a very proud citizen. And I'm a product of the same democracy. Well, I owe my upbringing to some very, very bright, brilliant schooling and very good parenting, Indian parents, who had the vision to look ahead for their own daughters. So India also has two extremes. It has those parents who love their daughters. And there are those parents who think daughters are going to be a liability and a lot of investment will go into getting them married. But that's changing. But it's a legacy. You have my kind in this country, and you have the other kind as well. So you got India is also a land of extremes, where you have women right at the top, a woman prime minister, a woman the top cop of the country, a woman who's the finance minister of this country. She's also been a defense minister of this country. And you also have women who are still looking for opportunities in certain areas of this country. So India's a great, that's why it's a part of order in disorder, or disorder in order. And that's a real challenge which we all face in this country in administration. Sorry, I didn't come prepared for any lecture. Looking at the diversity, and since you've traveled so much, traversed this country, I wanted to put things in context for you. Why you see me kind of, and why you might just see other kind of, and then you need an answer. And the answer is a legacy of a huge bulgeoning population. When we got independence from England in 1947, we were one-fourth of this population, or rather little about one-third. Imagine, if at that time, the leaders of that country had worked on population management control, we would have been richer like America. We would have been. But that was not the priority at that time for the leadership. At that time, the leadership was consolidation, somehow managed the huge partition and dislocation and migration which was happening. And the poverty at that time, and the lack of schooling and industry and educational institutions. So at that time, the challenge was setting up engineering colleges, the medical colleges, the information technology colleges. And that was done, of which we reap the rewards. But at that time alongside, if population management had also happened, India would have been a very, very prosperous, developed country by now. Against the background of its very strong spiritual heritage. India is a heritage of temples rather than universities. Whereas the Western world was setting up engineering and universities and bridges, we were setting up temples and religious places. That's the difference. When I read more and more of history, I find a big difference. While at that time the Western world is building a university of the Harvards and the MITs and others and building a bridge, we are building the longest and the tallest temple in the world, or the richest temple in the world. So that was the kind of heritage. That's why it's East and the West. So when it wants to matters of the soil, people travel to India. When it comes to technology and engineering, people travel there. But now, both are getting intermixed. They're getting intermixed because both are needed. You need both human engineering, inner engineering, and hardcore engineering. It's finally a mixture of two. You need hardcore and you need softcore. And that's why a successful human being or a successful country is one which balances both. And that's what India is trying to do right now, is balancing both the hard and the soft softwares. Hardware and software. But India is brilliant in its software. There's no doubt about it. That's why you find people rather contented, because there is an inner core which keeps them going and settled and contented sometimes with little. And in the West, even maximum is not enough. Maximum is not enough because you want more. Here people sometimes settle with less. But people like us who finally got through, out of this, crossed the, we want more. So we have opened another world. So when we kind of want more, we produce more. We create more. And that's what India takes you towards, greater towards scientific prosperity. I'm sorry.
No.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm an administrator at the moment. Here. I'm the 30th lieutenant governor of this place.
Ms. Bedi is the top cop. She was the top cop of India. And even the Prime Minister wouldn't dare, to come close to her. She had some reforms done for the traffic. I still remember my father's car, who was in the Air Force, he was Air Marshal then, was towed away. But he had such immense respect for her because she actually managed to control the mess we had in Delhi.
Oh, and, now I know the mess so.
And, thank
you. As an Indian, yes, I guess it would be part of the news and developments. Thank you so much. Where do you live, Rohit?
No, I come from Amritsar, very close to
my India. Hometown.
Yes. And all fruit juice, laying next to yours.
Wow.
Native home, I live.
That's great.
She was again ace tennis player.
Very good. Yeah, I belong to a very well-known tennis playing family in this country. I went on to become India's number one, and then I went to win the Asian tennis title as well. And then I moved into the National Indian Police Service.
Very good. Excellent.
And then in 1972, when I joined the Indian Police Service, I became the first woman in my country to join. I did not know when I said I want to join the officer ranks of the Indian Police Service. When they said, are you sure you want to join? But I said, I thought we qualified. And it's equally qualification. Why should somebody ask me this question? They said, but it's a very tough job. But I said, well, so am I.
Excellent.
And I didn't know it was breaking, making breakthroughs. And since then, the numbers of women in the officer ranks of the elite Indian police, which means you reach right to the top. It's been commissioners and director generals of police. Some, many of them have reached the top and even retired, like I did. I retired a few years ago, and then one day invited to become the lieutenant governor of this place by my prime minister. This is one of the first time a posting came to my in my life, whereas asked, would you like to go? Earlier I used to say, posted. And without knowing how long I would last there. Here I was told, would you like to go there? By my current prime minister. And I was quite amazed that in my whole career, all along, never would I ever been called and asked, would you like to go there? I just got an order in writing, posted. And since I didn't know how long, I used every day of my life to the maximum. See, because before it flies out of my hands. With the result that anywhere I worked, one day was like 4 days of work. There was something in the morning, something in the afternoon, something in the evening, and something during the... It was so intense work that we multiplied the day into four. And that's exactly what we're doing here. We're creating so much of goodwill and work that the area needs. Because we feel that we are here for a cause, for a purpose. We are on a mission mode to make things better here one day at a time. I think Asha is going to show you something.
Yes, I
think so. I think she might show you some visual. Asha is the controller of the Raj Nivas. If you find it all good, it's because of her.
And you're talking to the mega icon, Dr. Bedi.
He got a great team, and Asha is the one who's really preserved and looks after this as absolutely more than her own home. She's been there before I came. Therefore, the well-being of this place belongs to me because of her. I'm a beneficiary of this. So maybe you can go up there and you can see a few things. If you still have a little time, we'll chat.
Thank you so much.